está brotando agua de vida saludable para ti. Cristo es la peña de Oreb que está brotando agua de vida saludable para ti. Ven a tomarla que es más dulce que la miel. Refresca el alma, refresca todo tu ser. Cristo es la peña de Oreb que está brotando agua de vida saludable.
The Old Testament Book of Esther contains a powerful statement concerning an individual woman's desire to see her people redeemed out of destruction. Esther's statement encapsulates my desire to tell the story of the Puerto Rican people, their children, and their literature, because I have asked myself a similar question. How can I endure to see the evil that shall come unto my people? How can I endure to see the destruction of my kindred? Since beginning my doctoral program as a Puerto Rican woman and scholar, I have begun to write about the sociocultural issues and injustices evident in the area of Puerto Rican children's literature. In the past, I never wrote about my heritage, but focused on canonical Victorian and American literature, until one of my doctoral seminars gave me the opportunity to conduct research in the Baldwin Library. I uncovered a treasure of Puerto Rican children's literature and authors that I shamefully had never known. I also discovered that this literature's legacy was virtually forgotten, even ignored, along with the details of how the United States shut down the Puerto Rican children's presses on the island, buffeting the creation of a Puerto Rican national children's literature. Instead, the United States created its own brand of American-authored texts, which presented the Puerto Rican people as colonial subjects with very little to say about their own conditions and experiences. These texts can be seen at the Baldwin Library, along with Puerto Rican-authored texts by mainland Puerto Ricans such as Pura Belpre, Nicolás Amor, and Judith Coffer Ortiz, that have more of a resistance against those texts, creating more of a sense of a Puerto Rican American identity. This is my grandmother's literacy test certificate. She had to take this test in order to vote in the elections in New York State and in New York City. These tests were given to many Puerto Ricans and African Americans before the Civil Rights Movement. If you look at the date, you'll see that it is actually 2 years past the year that the Supreme Court ruled these types of tests unconstitutional. Yet they gave my grandmother the test anyway, knowing that it was no longer constitutional. This is my father, Carlos, and his two brothers, Raymond and Gennaro. This picture was taken just before his family moved to the United States to begin their lives in New York City. My father is the one with black hair in the back. My father grew to become a United States Marine Corps sergeant. He became the graduate of Inter-American University in Puerto Rico. He is also the father of two daughters, one who was a lawyer and one who was studying to get her PhD. I am very proud of my father. If I were to ask you what you knew about Puerto Rican history, or about Puerto Ricans in general, you might say Jennifer Lopez, Ricky Martin, Daddy Yankee. Very rarely would anyone think of the Puerto Ricans who came over to the United States in the 20s on planes and on ships looking for a better future for their children and their families. These are people who were made American citizens yet came to this country with absolutely nothing, and it would seem people have even forgotten why they came or if they're even here. Beyond West Side Story, there is another story of women, men, and children who came to this country looking for a better life, and I'm determined to see that they find it.
Edwin, seguimos unidos. Pelo, se volvió a prender la fiesta. Ezequiel.
Cuando el faraón dejó ir al pueblo, Jehová les guió por por el desierto cuando el faraón dejó ir al pueblo. Jehová les guió por el desierto, él iba delante de ellos, él iba delante de ellos. Por el día columna de nube, en la noche columna de fuego. Por el día columna de nube, por la noche columna de fuego, papá. Y seguimos unidos con unción tropical. ¡Ay, papá!
I attribute the destruction that I see befalling the Puerto Rican people to the devaluing of Puerto Rican culture and history in the U.S. The ignorance and disinterest surrounding American concepts of Puerto Ricans, I believe, have contributed to the reality that Puerto Rican students are among the lowest performing in U.S. schools, with the second highest national dropout rate. In my research, I have realized the rarity of my position as a highly educated professional among my community, and I find it unacceptable. I have continually encountered the kind of ignorance and apathy surrounding Puerto Rican issues within the U.S. Although I lived in the States since I was 5, people remark at how well I speak English. You have no accent, they tell me, as if it were a compliment. Once a professor, who I am sure meant no harm, asked me jokingly, "Where is your switchblade?" Recently, another professor advised me that I should not focus my doctoral studies on Puerto Rican issues because it would limit my job prospects as a serious professor. I believe this ignorance, whether intentionally or unintentionally, has licensed a continual demeaning of the Puerto Rican people's value in American history. As I look at my family, history, their struggles both on the island and on the mainland, I cannot help but see their experience as invisible in American culture. Beyond popular portrayals like West Side Story, I believe this kind of invisibility has affected Puerto Rican children's treatment and performance in the American classroom. For example, Puerto Ricans are wrongfully the objects of xenophobic send them all back arguments, which are ludicrous since they are born American citizens. The Puerto Rican paradox is somewhere between being considered a stranger in your own land, yet being denied the right to see yourself as a descendant of a sovereign nation because of the Puerto Rican's status as a conquered commonwealth. School systems and researchers lump Puerto Rican children into the formless Hispanic category, which I believe limits educators' abilities to reach and access this group. I believe American school systems have a particular responsibility to students who become part of their classrooms through conquest and colonization, particularly when they are continually identified as underachievers and at risk. I see children's literature as an important part of a solution in reaching at-risk Puerto Rican youth because I believe the inclusion of positive Puerto Rican children's literature and authors can not only impact children's reading abilities, but their overall perception of education and its societal advantages. This is my mother, Carmen, and her two aunts, Tia Luisa and Tia Matilde. My mother was a school teacher for 20 years in the United States and in Puerto Rico. I have always seen my mother trying to help children in some way, whether through teaching or programs, child development. She comes from a long line of teachers. My aunt, Tia Matilde, who you see in the back in this picture, who is holding me, is also a teacher and worked in Puerto Rico for many years in rural Puerto Rico. One of her students, Esmeralda Santiago, actually featured my aunt, Tia Matilde, in her book, When I Was Puerto Rican. However, if you ask my aunt, Tia Matilde, about that book and her appearance in it, she'd probably just tell you that she is really proud of one of her students. I can see how education has made the difference in my family, and I can see how efforts like what my aunt, Tia Matilde, has done in other students' lives have changed their lives and given them the ability to have different opportunities, such as Miss Santiago's book. I want that same opportunity to be had by all children, and especially Puerto Rican students and children, because it is so strong of a passion in my heart. My passion for this subject can be simplified very easily. I just very well feel that I was born to tell this story to you.
Book of Revelation, uh-huh. Chapter 7, verses 16 and 17.
Yes, sir.
They shall hunger no more, neither shall they thirst any more.
Preach, preacher.
For God shall wipe away,
yes, sir,
every tear from their eyes.
Yes, sir.
Get ready.